Resurrection. Somebody worship him this morning. Come on, the King is alive this morning, church. There ain't nobody in that tomb. Hey, Matthew, can I see your water? Y'all got me all different flavors out of shit. Praise the Lord. How many of you guys were at our Good Friday service? All right, three of you, sick. It was a wonderful time we had with the Lord. You know, a lot of us like to, at this season, kind of walk through those days together. Good Friday, we tend to take a moment and think about the crucifixion. Let it weigh on us. Let us understand the weight of our sin, the weight of his glory and sacrifice. We like to take that Saturday, understand what it must have felt like for some of them. Everything that Jesus had spoke to them seemed to have gone out the window. He said he was going to be back. He's not here. He said he was going to stay, and I watched him die. I know where his body is. Then Sunday came. And we've been living in that ever since. The glory of this day is eternal. If you're a saint in this house, you need to celebrate. Come on. If you are alive and well in this house and you know that Jesus is Lord, don't wait for the song you know. Don't wait for that one thing that makes you sing right. So I asked Matthew a few months back, he said, man, I really want to do something different for Easter. He said, I don't know what it is. I don't know how to tell this story any different than we've told it before. I said, then let's not. Let's celebrate that story. Let's celebrate the risen King of Glory this morning. So that's what we're here to do. So worship's going to be a little bit longer today than it usually is. And we're going to go a little louder than we usually do, because the King of Glory is alive and well this morning. That grave is empty and that throne is occupied.
He reigns in victory. And sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring.
We're going to sing that again.
And sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. What he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, my future is heaven. I praise God.
Worship him. Oh, he's good.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, if he's alive, then he's in this room today, folks. If he's in this room, then anything can happen. Come on, let's just speak that name, Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
And I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Your name is power.
'Cause your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name. Fear and all anxiety. Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness, hope for every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy.
Just lift those hands. If you got family members that need that name today, just lift your hands all over this room. Come on, stand in their space. Oh, I speak Jesus. Oh, for my home, for my family. Come on, let's declare this.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over.
God, King of all kings, precious Jesus, we We believe that you are alive this morning. But more than that, we believe that you are here this morning, Lord. I feel your presence all around, Father. Lord, you are the resurrection. Lord, you are the resurrection. You are the resurrection power. You are the power. Father, believe that I'm not the only one in this room today that needs a touch from you. Father, I believe that I'm not the only one in this room today that has a family that needs a healing. I can't be the only one in this room that needs that name, Jesus. And I just feel like on a day where you want to, where we come to celebrate you, all you really want to do is show off. Just show us who you are, God. Father, may we not be quick to move from moment to moment today, God. May we bask in your presence. May we enjoy your presence in this room. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. That means bondage can't sit in that presence. That means darkness can't sit in that presence. You are the light in our darkness, Father. You are the key to the things that held us bound. To your Lord be the honor and glory forever and ever. Father, I pray that you would take over this time, Lord. I pray that as Matthew brings a word, Father, that you would fill him with fire. God, you would break this place out, Lord. Father, we surrender to your design today. Whatever it is you want to do, come and have your way. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Happy Easter. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
All right. I'm so glad that you chose to be here this morning. My name is Matthew Bradham. I'm the campus pastor here at Point Church Cary. Today is everything. Today is everything. If you're looking for a church, we would love to be a church home for you. And the only reason a church exists anywhere in the world is because of this day. There would be no church, there would be no Sunday service without a risen Lord and an empty tomb. And so we invite you to experience the risen Lord Jesus Christ this morning. If you're new to our church this morning, if you're a guest, there's a connect card in the pockets in front of you. We would love for you to grab one of those. Go ahead and begin filling that out. We don't believe we're the only church in town. There's a bunch of amazing churches around here, but if you're looking for a church this Easter, we would, first of all, mark on there that you're a guest. Let us know that you're checking out a church, and we challenge you to try five, see if this is a church for you. We hope it is. We would love for this to be a family for you, but if it's not, we would love to help you find the one that the Holy Spirit's actually leading you to. So please, try five with us. Check that you're a guest on there. Fill out some information. We can't be a family if we can't connect. So we would love to connect with you this week and over the next month. Also, turn it over on the back. Maybe there's some next steps on there. Maybe you're just dying for community. Maybe you're looking for some people to connect with. Just check that you're interested in a life group. Maybe you're interested in using the gifts that God's given you. You can check on there that you're interested in serving. Maybe you're interested in learning what it is to become a follower of Jesus. This is completely new to you. You can check that right now before the sermon is even preached. That you're interested in becoming a follower of Jesus. You can check you want to meet with someone on staff. Or maybe you've never been baptized. Maybe you've never gone all the way under the water and all the way out as a follower of Jesus to say, I have died with Christ and I have been raised with him. If that's you today, we would love for you to check that, and we would love to follow up with you and watch you be raised to life. I'm so excited you're here. I cannot wait for God to meet us in a powerful way through his word this morning. Father, I just ask right now. Father, I pray that you would just anoint my mouth and my mind. Holy Spirit, I pray that you, Holy Spirit, in Scripture, you were described like a dove. God, I pray that you would just fly all around this room. You're described as being like wind. May the wind of your Holy Spirit just blow amongst us. God, I pray that nobody would leave this room unchanged today. We believe that you are here. And where you are, nothing should remain the same. God, I pray that pride would not get in the way today. God, I pray that idols would not get in the way today. God, I pray that people's dreams would not get in the way today. God, I pray that the schedule for tomorrow and the next day or this afternoon wouldn't get in the way today. God, I pray that the burden that people carried on the way in here wouldn't blind them from your reality. Would you just move in this place? Would you save us? Lord, save us from ourselves, Lord. God, I pray that if there's those today that don't know you, that they would walk into your glory today. Those that already are followers of Jesus, that they would walk out of that tomb fresh and anew again. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. John chapter 20, verse 3. John chapter 20, verse 3. You can turn there, you can click there, you can stare there. The words will be up there. If you don't have a Bible, I would love to give you a free one in the lobby after this. Bring your Connect card to the lobby. We would love to give you a Bible for free. It says this in John chapter 20, starting in verse 1, rather. It says, early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. Sometimes you don't even need to preach. You can just read it. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him. So Peter and the other disciple, who we know to be John, started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Jesus wasn't there. That's the Easter sermon. Jesus wasn't in the tomb. Jesus wasn't in the tomb. For those of you that are followers of Jesus, you know how this goes. If you're new, it's okay. You get a pass. But when I say things like Jesus is in the tomb, that should conjure up a response in you. Jesus wasn't in the tomb. Growing up every year of my life, my mom would wake me up with the words, the tomb is empty. The tomb is empty. The tomb is empty. And as good of news as it was, you don't always want to be woken up loudly. But she would say, the tomb is empty. I don't live with my mom anymore. I'm married and have two kids, but let me tell you, she ain't stopped. Because the first thing I saw after I slept through three alarms, yes, I did, on Easter Sunday, I rolled over and I looked at my phone and I panicked, but I stopped panicking once I saw the text that said the tomb is empty. All that was in the tomb were grave clothes. All that was in the tomb was grave clothes, the strips of linen that were around his body and the cloth that was wrapped around his head. And you know what? It's fitting that they were there. Because grave clothes belong in graves. Grave clothes belong in graves. Dead things belong in graves. Dead people belong in tombs. The reason Jesus died on the cross on Friday was because we were dead. Scripture teaches us, not physically speaking, but spiritually, that the wages of our sin was death, that we were dead in our sins is what it teaches us. And what do we know about dead things? Dead things belong in graves. And physically speaking, spiritually speaking, eternally speaking, we belong in graves. Sinners belong on crosses. Jesus wasn't a sinner, but he hung on a cross because we are. Jesus died on the cross for our sins, not his. It wasn't until every sin that had been committed prior and the present and ever would be, it wasn't until then that Jesus uttered the words from the cross with his last breaths. He said, "It is finished," that we might be forgiven. Anybody thankful for the forgiveness of sins by Jesus Christ? But the crazy thing about Easter is that Jesus didn't need to be forgiven for a daggone thing, but we did. You know why people forgive people? Listen, you might tell someone you're sorry when you're mad, but you ain't forgiven them. Forgiveness is not done out of guilt. You don't forgive someone out of obligation. The only thing that really births forgiveness is love. I don't care what the song said. It was not your sin, my sin, somebody else's sin. It was not our sin that held him there. Your sin is not powerful enough to hold the King of Glory on a cross. In fact, nothing is powerful enough to hold the King of Glory on a cross. What kept the King of Glory on a cross was his love. His love for you, his love for the world, his love for me held him there. Sinners belong on crosses and sinners belong in graves. But we know that Jesus wasn't a sinner, which means he didn't belong in a grave. So you know what? He didn't stay in one. And he left the linens in the tomb. He left the cloth that was wrapped around his head in the tomb because dead things belong in graves. And he wasn't dead any longer. Now, that's the story of Jesus on Easter 2,000 plus years ago. But what's your story this Easter? You see, a tomb would be a dark place, a desolate, dark, hopeless place. But you see, what happens is a really dark tomb all of a sudden gets a really different atmosphere when the stone is rolled away. Because when the stone is rolled away, all of a sudden the light starts to pierce the darkness. That dark tomb all of a sudden is penetrated by the light of life, by the light of possibilities, by the light of freedom, by the light of hope, by the light of transformation. That light starts to pierce into that dark tomb. And Jesus, hear me, is waiting outside of that tomb with a nail-pierced hand, and he's inviting you to grab a hold of it and walk out. Sometimes when people are placed in caskets, we like to honor them and we put things in that casket that were special to them. Sometimes, I don't know, you might put a piece of gum in there or a Walkman because that was special back then. Or you might put a picture or you might put a key. You might put something there. But as sweet as that is, let me just break your heart a little bit. Here's the truth. When you're dead, you can't take anything with you. But let me flip this around. You can't bring dead things out of the tomb. Dead things belong in tombs, and if you want to be alive outside the tomb, dead things must stay in dead places. Dead things must stay in dead places, because what business do dead things have amongst the living? What business do dead things have amongst the living? Jesus died on the cross to forgive you, and he walked out of a tomb to free you. It says this in Romans chapter 6, verses 5 and 7. Through 7, it says, for if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. To be united with him in a death like his is to recognize that Jesus died for your sins to forgive you of them. But it also means that you choose to die to the things that he died for. It's not enough just to understand that he died for you. It's to choose to die to yourself, to say, I choose to say dead things remain in dead places. To unite with him in his resurrection is to leave dead things where dead things belong and walk out of your own grave and accept the freedom of the outstretched arm of Jesus. It says that our old self can be crucified with him so that our life would no longer be ruled by sin. Like, this is the part of the gospel that very often doesn't get preached. The gospel is not simply the forgiveness of sins. The gospel is also freedom from sin. Because let me tell you, a depressive Christian existence is to know that you're forgiven, but to live your life as if you are still not free from the power of that sin. Prior to the death of Christ, we are enslaved to sin. But Jesus died that you might be set free, not only from the penalty of sin, hear me, to set you set free from the power of sin. Because not only does he forgive you, he frees you, but he also fills you. Let me tell you, a forgiven life without a filled life is still a life that's not that wonderful. But it says that he raised from the dead, and 50 days later, he ascended into heaven, and he was seated at the right hand of the Father, and on Pentecost Sunday, he poured out his Holy Spirit. And in Acts chapter 2, a sermon was preached, and they asked the Apostle Peter, what must we do? He said, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The good news this morning is if you leave dead things in dead places and walk out of your own grave and grab a hold of a nail-pierced hand of Jesus, not only are you receiving forgiveness, you're receiving the same power that raised him. Because Jesus walked out of a grave, so can you. Because Jesus walked out of a grave, so can you. To walk towards something, hear me, is to walk away from something. To walk towards someone is to walk away from someone. To walk out of the tomb toward Jesus is to walk away from the things of this world. That's the choice that we have to make in this life is, will I leave dead things that are killing me? Will I leave them where they belong in a grave? And will I walk out and experience the freedom and the power of his resurrection? When the stone rolled away, Jesus left the linen and the cloth in the tomb, but he didn't walk out naked, just to let you know. He walked out in resurrected clothes, heavenly clothes, holy and righteous clothes. And you know what Jesus does? He says, let me give you my wardrobe. It says that he wants to clothe you with his righteousness and his holiness. You're like, I'm messed up. He knows, but he isn't. And he says, let me put my clothes on you. And those are the clothes he offers to clothe you with. If you'll let dead things be dead, bow your knee to your resurrected Lord and surrender your life to his living ways. But you might be asking, what about all the things I've done? Anybody done any messed up stuff? We got a whole lot of liars in the room. Anybody here have things that you regret? Anybody have those things still hold weight over you? They still cloud your thoughts and your mind. You know, do you know what the cross and the empty tomb did? Is it sets you free from having to always dwell upon the things that you've done and the things that you just did. Because here's the good news. Our world says that you are defined by what you do. That is slavery. And you can never be broken from that kind of slavery. But the good news of this on Easter is that you are not defined by what you do. You are defined by what Jesus did. You are not defined by the life that you have lived. You are defined by the life that Jesus has lived. I feel like so often this life, it's like everybody's living the scarlet letter we read in ninth grade over and over and over again. You know what? We live a world that's filled with cancel culture. You know the gospel is anti-cancel culture? Because the gospel cancels sins. And if the gospel cancels sins, then we have no business canceling anybody. Because what we have done does not define us. To walk out of the tomb is to be forgiven and free. You know what? A grave is a depressing place until you realize it's empty. A grave is a depressing place until you realize it's empty, which means when you look back on the sins in your life, they aren't the scarlet letter that you wear. You can look back on dead things and you can smile because you know that you are eternally crucified and buried with Christ. Later that Easter morning, Mary Magdalene saw Jesus, but she didn't recognize him at first. It says this in verse 14. It says, at this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, woman, why are you crying? Why is it? Who is it you were looking for? Thinking he was the gardener, just to let you know, She wasn't totally wrong. He is the gardener that wants to prune the dead things off of you. Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him and I will get him." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. In the other gospels, we see that there were other women with her, and they fell down at his feet and they held on to him and they worshiped him. Jesus in resurrected form isn't initially recognizable to Mary, and I want you to know that's important. Because when you walk out of the grave into the arms of Jesus, receiving forgiveness and walking in freedom of your sin, you are embracing a life that should look unrecognizable to the rest of the world. When you walk out of the tomb, people shouldn't recognize you. You know the thing that everybody wants in this life is, could I just start over? Could I just get a second chance? And the gospel and the tomb that is empty on Easter says, oh, yes, you can. I'm not asking you to change this morning. I'm asking you to be changed. You can't change yourself. Stop trying. Allow him to change you this morning. Do you want to live a life that's unrecognizable to the life prior? One of the most common wishes that we have is that we wish that we could live a life differently than the life we've been living. If you want that this morning, what you need to do is you need to say, I understand that the way I've been living is dead. And I need to, just like Jesus left his linens and his cloths in a grave, we need to say, I'm going to leave the ways that I've been living. I leave them where dead things belong. And I choose to be changed by the power of the Holy Spirit. And I walk out in newness of life. And the life I will live from this day forward will be unlike any day I have ever lived before. Mary came to mourn what was lost, but she ended up worshiping what was found. Instead of honoring what was, she ended up honoring what is and always will be. If you're here this morning and you're like, I don't know what to do, the answer is this. You are a sinner. I am a sinner. Jesus was not. He was fully God and he was fully man. And he left the glory of heaven because he saw our broken, dead state. And he came out of love. He came out of love and he said, let me die for your sin. Let me be raised for your freedom. Let me ascend so that you can be filled. If you're here today and you're like, I need a new life. I need to be transformed. I need to be changed. I need to receive forgiveness. He died for your forgiveness, but listen, it's your job to receive it. Have you ever said, I forgive somebody and they didn't receive it? You have to receive it. You have to receive the forgiveness that he offers and say, Jesus, you are Lord. You are the crucified, risen Lord. You are seated on the throne. And I recognize that you left dead things where dead places belong. And I choose to leave the dead sin, the dead ways, the dead idols, the dead dreams. I choose to leave them in a dead place. And I choose to walk out into the land of the living. You repent. You say, I repent, I turn from my sin. I leave it in a dead place and I walk out into glory. I repent and say, Jesus is Lord, and surrender your life fully to him. If that's you this morning, listen, we've got a beautiful story today. We've got a sweet little girl named Peyton who's being baptized today. We've got a gentleman named Jonathan who's being baptized today. We have the waters of baptism ready every single week. Now, Easter's a tricky day to get baptized because here's the deal. Everybody, you know, not everybody, but a lot of times it's like, well, I'm going to put on my Easter gear. Well, to get baptized, you got to take off your Easter gear. And it's like, well, I'm not going to change. I'll plan that for another day. Let me just tell you, you don't know you have another day. You know what's funny is when you try to plan the things that you want to do for God when you're not God. What if today is the last day you have? That's not a scare tactic. That's just reality. We don't talk about judgment. Let me just tell you the truth. He died for your sin, but until you walk out of that grave, do you know where you remain? In that grave. Just because he died doesn't mean he yanks you out. Because he's not going to force you to love him. He's not going to force you to submit to him. But his hand is always outstretched. Let me say over this house today, today is the day of salvation. And in a room this large right now, there's two people should not be the only people baptized today. Today is the day. You're like, well, I can't get baptized in my brand new dress. Well, that's okay. I don't expect you to. We got clothes for you. We've got clothes ready for everybody every day, and especially on Easter, we're ready to say, hey, are you ready to walk out of your grave? Are you ready to accept and receive his forgiveness and to walk out in the freedom of the power of sin and be filled with the Holy Spirit? Listen, if that's you today, in a minute, we're going to start worshiping again. I'm going to be down front here with my wife. Come down and speak with us. We would love to walk you into the hands of Jesus. Maybe you still have questions and you don't know, like, I just don't know. I don't understand. That's okay. But let me tell you, those questions are too important just to leave there. Maybe some of you are followers of Jesus today. And maybe you already walked out of that tomb, but you find yourself sitting in the grave today. You see, if someone's been raised from the dead, the last place they should be and the last place they should stay is in a tomb. But sometimes we hang out in a tomb because it's what we're most familiar with, no matter how disgusting that is. My kids have a really bad habit of wearing dirty clothes. We have to ask our children on a daily basis, where did you get your clothes from? Because we can't always remember. We're like, did you get your clothes from the hamper? Kids are gross. But you know why they do that? It's because they like those dirty clothes better than clean clothes. And sometimes, followers of Jesus, let me speak to you and challenge you. Sometimes we like the dead clothes and the dirty clothes better than clean clothes. And what happens is people that have been forgiven and set free end up walking back into that tomb and hanging out in dead places with dead things and dead ways, and it should not be. You see, you've been given a holy and righteous wardrobe. Don't go back to the hamper. Don't go back to the hamper and put on clothes that reek of death. It's what we do. We so often go back to the grave. Let me tell you something. This world needs Jesus. Anybody read the news, seen things, been around people, you know this world needs Jesus? Okay, let me challenge you, Christians. I just challenge people that weren't Christians to receive forgiveness and to walk out of a tomb. You know one of the biggest reasons that people don't become Christians? Christians. Gandhi's biggest problem wasn't Jesus. He liked Jesus. He didn't like Christians. Because there was a problem with him that he saw people that didn't understand that he said, follow the things that he said. There is a dying world out here. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, here's the truth. For the wages of sin is death. And to not walk out of that grave that he has rolled the stone away from is to remain there forever separated from God for the rest of your life and the rest of eternity. That is truth. Just because he died doesn't mean he saves the world. He died to save the world, but the world has to choose whether they'll receive that salvation. And listen, followers of Jesus, you have a big task at hand. And it's not to be perfect. It's to submit to the perfect one. And it's to choose to yield to him and put on his clothes that he gave you. It says the world will know that we love him by the way that we love one another. And listen, followers of Jesus, you want to see the world flipped upside down? Stop hanging out in your old grave. Stop putting on old clothes. Stop grabbing a hold of the cloths and the linens that were left there. They belong in dead places. See, when the world sees people that want nothing to do with the things of the grave, and they've actually believed that the ways of Jesus are better than anything the grave has to offer, they might actually believe the message we have to preach. Dead things belong in dead places. You know what doesn't belong in dead places? People that are alive. And I invite you to live. I invite you to live this Easter. If you're here and you don't know Jesus, I invite you to walk out of your grave. I invite you to walk out of your grave to receive the forgiveness of Jesus and to walk out in the freedom of that sin and the power of the Holy Spirit. If you're a follower of Jesus today, and you've crept back in there, you've grabbed a hold of a dream of the world, you've grabbed a hold of an idol again, you've grabbed a hold of that old sin that used to be a habit in your life, you know what? I'm not here to shame you. I'm here to tell you that thing's still dead. And it's not bringing you life. And to put the cloths and the linen down and to walk out to the, you know what's good about Jesus? Is if you're a follower of Jesus, every time you walk back in, the hand is still always reaching out. And he's reaching out his hand today and he's saying, won't you please walk back out again? Sweet child, that thing stinks. take it off, walk out, and put on glory. Jesus, we love you. We love you. You are worthy. Oh, hail King Jesus. God, I pray that today we would understand the dead things belong in graves, but praise you, Jesus, that you're not dead. And you are in the business of saving sinners. And God, I pray that we wouldn't shy away from the fact that sin is sin, and this room is filled with sinners. But the good news about Jesus is that he changes our status. Because he left the cloths and the linens in the tomb, he stands on the outside and he shines his light into the darkness of this world and the darkness of our hearts and minds and souls. And he says, I already defeated your dead things. I already defeated your dead thoughts. I already defeated your dead ways. You think that addiction is too great? I already killed it. You think that depression is too much? I speak that loudly right now. It's already been killed. All the ways of this world have already been defeated. You're like, why is the world so messed up? Well, it's because the world hasn't walked out of the grave. Don't blame Jesus. He's already outside of it. The ones to blame are those that haven't yet walked outside of the tomb where the stone has been rolled away. Today, I pray that you would bring people out of the grave into the garden. Oh God, would you set us free today? And may this room all of a sudden, maybe people today walked in with their nasty death clothes, but I pray as we finish worshiping in celebration that in this moment, we wouldn't worship in shame. We would just take off those clothes and we put on holy and righteousness that you've given us, and we worship you the way that we were saved to do so. We ask all this in the mighty name of Jesus, amen. Would you stand with me? You received communion elements when you came in. Jesus said, on Thursday before Sunday, he gave them this meal and he said, this bread represents my body broken for you. Take this in remembrance of me. You know what we remember is that his body was broken on a cross and we take communion. But you know what we should also remember every time we take communion? He said, take this as often as you gather until I come again. The good news is we take it remembering his body was broken. We also take it remembering his body was fixed. Thank you, Jesus, for your broken body. Hebrews says that there is no sin, there is no forgiveness of sins without the shedding of blood. And on that Thursday, he said, this represents my blood shed for you. Take this in remembrance of me. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood. All right, listen, we're about to worship. You know what else might actually lead the Holy Spirit in this room to stir people to walk out of their own grave today? It would be when saints actually worship like people that have walked out of graves. We're gonna sing about his worthiness. We're gonna hail him as king. And what I hope that we see right now is an eruption of praise of the one who stands outside and shines his light into the darkness of the grave. Worthy, worthy. Worthy is King Jesus.
God, we love you. We worship you. We welcome you in this place. There was a moment when the lights went out. When death had claimed its victory, the King of love had given up his life. The darkest day in history, there on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake, and the veil was torn. What a sacrifice was made as the heavens roar. Come on, lift it up today.
Sing that one more time. All hail King Jesus.
The world. All hail King Jesus. Oh, come on, hands lifted across this room. Of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Savior of the world. Come on, let's just give him praise today. God, you're so worthy. You're worthy of our worship. You're worthy of our praise. Thank you, Jesus. It was my cross you bore, so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name, Jesus.
You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all.
your voice.
Worthy is your name.
He's worthy.
Worthy is your name, Jesus.
You deserve.
You deserve praise.
No one like you.
Worthy is your name. Worthy, worthy. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve.
To him. Let's just sit right here for a second. Step deeper in his presence today. He's waiting for us.
Yeah.
Empty. The tomb is empty. Woo! And in a way I will never fully understand, the tomb is empty because Jesus isn't in it, but it's filled with my sin. And that's where it belongs, and that's where it'll stay. Worthy is your name, King Jesus.
Yes, Lord. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve it all, God.
We give you glory and honor.
You deserve it all, God.
God, I pray that you would stir this room. Lord, if there's anyone in here today that still hasn't responded when they knew the Holy Spirit was beating down the door of their heart the whole service, if there's anybody today that needs to still give their life to Jesus and walk out of that tomb, God, I pray they'd come find me. I pray they'd find Tawana and Derek over here, Chuck and Debbie in the back, Larry and April. Lord, anybody, Brian and Yaffe in another corner, Brian and Sherry, I don't even know who all is where, but find somebody. God, I pray that you would stir people so much right now. Lord, even if they have to stay a second service, they will. Oh, God, may we all walk out of that tomb that you rolled the stone away from. People that are set free don't belong in graves. May we walk in freedom and in power. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, thank y'all so much for coming today. I want to let you know, we got a photo booth out in the lobby. We would love for all of you to get your Easter photos done. It's like one of those Polaroid ones that it prints it out, and it's really awesome and cool. Also, we're starting a new series next week called Doubting God. And we're looking at the post-resurrection appearances of when Jesus appeared to people after his resurrection. Little thing you might know about is that even if you're a follower of Jesus and you've walked out of that tomb, some of us still deal with doubt. Amen? Amen, that means you like it. It means it's true. And the question we're going to look at is what leads to doubt? It's fears. It's questions. It's so many different things. But the question is, where is Jesus in the midst of our fear? And that's where we'll see. Also, invite somebody to come to church with you. Most people say that they would come if someone would just invite them. So invite someone to come next week as we start a new series. Be blessed.